Welcome back to the channel. In this video, we will look at the things I have powered with this power station. If you want to see the video about a detailed review of this power station, click on the link right here. You can also find the link in the description below. And I have been running all of my household appliances from this power station for most of 2022. I powered pretty much anything around the house that you can possibly plug in. If you can plug it in, I powered it. I powered the TV, my entertainment station, I powered the refrigerator, microwave, deep freezer, water cooler, blender, air compressor, power tool.
Coconut shrimp, pepper shrimp,
shrimp soup, shrimp stew. That's about it.
And a lot of other items that you see on the list. At the end of the video, we will take a look at my power bill and see how much power I saved using this power station. Let's go over the power sequence and start this thing up. So the first thing we needed to do is connect our solar panel array. We have our breaker currently in the off position. And now the PV array is connected. The next thing that we have to do is connect the battery. Now that the battery is plugged in, you'll notice the power indicator LED on the shunt will turn on. Right now we have power to the main terminals here, positive, and here, negative. The reason why the shunt is on and nothing else is on is because the shunt needs to remain on at all times to read the battery status. The next thing we have to do is pre-charge the system. This button right here allows a little bit of power through the breaker and into the system. It'll pre-charge the capacitors in the inverter. And when that happens, this LED indicator will turn on. Let's do that now. Usually it takes about 5 to 10 seconds. It's already on. At this point, we can turn on the main breaker. And just to illustrate, when I push that button, how little current travels across these terminals, if I turn this switch on, and then press the button, you'll see the buck converter try to charge up, turn the light on, and discharge, try to turn up, turn the light on, and discharge back and forth like that. It's just a small amount of current, maybe 1 or 2 amps. At this point, our DC battery is connected, and we have DC power to the system. We can either turn on the inverter to get AC power, or we can turn on our DC switches to power our USB panels up here to get DC power. I'll show the DC side now. And now we have DC power at these USB outlets and the car adapter outlet. Now we can turn on the inverter. When I turn on the inverter, you'll hear a click sound. That means the AC output relay is connected to the AC power strip over here. Now we got 120 volts output. Now we can turn on our AC power strip. Okay, for the final step, we just have to turn on our PV array. Once it detects a PV array, you'll see a little icon pop up on the screen right here. Array is detected. Now it's testing the open circuit voltage to make sure it's within range for this unit. If it is, it'll connect and start charging the battery. It just connected. Now we're charging. Now let's look at the watts. This is how many watts is coming in from the PV array. 550, 700, 900. So we have a heat gun, and we're going to plug it into the AC output and see how many watts this heat gun draws. We need to change our display over to load watts. 1.6 kilowatts. So as the demand, when you put a heavy load on the inverter, the demand from the panels will increase, and it'll start pulling more power, available power, from the panels to power that load. And that's it for the startup sequence. Now that everything's powered up, let's see what other devices we can power around the house. We're going to use this huge green extension cord, go around the house and plug it into different appliances and see how much power it draws. Are you going to plug it in? Can you believe this guy? Why he's in there doing whatever it is that he's doing, we're going to pull up the Victron shunt and see how much power he's using. Oh crap, my phone's almost dead. Where could I possibly plug it in to get power? Problem solved. He's in there playing Warzone? Warzone. Let's see what we got here. So it looks like to run that gaming PC, it's pulling about 750 watts. And that machine has a 850 watt power supply. So here's our trend graph. We can see basically how it's trending over time. So if he continues to sit in there and rack up all those kills all day, the battery is going to be dead in about 10 hours. That's a 10.2 kilowatt hour battery. Let's test something else. What's he doing now? Making lunch? How much power is that going to take? 1100 watts. Wow, to run a toaster oven takes 1100 watts, 42 amps, and it's looking like it will take 8 hours and 30 minutes to run that toaster oven to completely deplete this battery. Let's check out the trend. So when a toaster oven starts up, it's, you know, room temperature, and it's got to heat up, so the initial draw, the initial preheat sequence will take about, I don't know, 3 minutes. And that's where the heaviest draw is going to be. So let's wait a while for that to happen. When the preheat sequence finishes, it'll go into just warming mode where the element will turn on, turn off, turn on, turn off. So our state of charge is currently at 88%. Okay, the toaster oven just turned off the preheat sequence. And now it's back up to 1,000 watts. We can actually see that in our trend if we zoom in. So there's our initial draw of 1,100 watts. And then it stopped, and it was only pulling 150. Was engaged here, drawing power, and then off again. And now we're doing a heat cycle again. So yeah, if you have a small system, like a 12-volt battery you're using, and it's only a couple hundred amp hours, cooking may or may not be on the books for you. You know, that takes a lot of power to heat up food. What do you think you're doing? Where's my lunch? You know how much power it costs to heat that food? Yeah, 1,200 watts, that's how much. Yeah, I don't think so. Get out of here. Yep, you can leave that there. Not bad. The next thing we're going to demonstrate is the versatility of the DC side. So we have our USB panels up here, and we have these 40 amp lugs at the bottom. We're going to power a 12 volt pump that has bare end wires. And we have a 400 watt small AC inverter that has alligator clips, and also it has a car adapter outlet. Okay, so the first test we're going to do is with our 400 watt AC inverter. We're going to plug it into the DC side, and we're going to monitor it on the shunt. Oh crap, my phone's getting low. Where could I possibly get DC power? Problem solved. So I'm going to plug this lamp into the AC side of this small inverter. And then we're going to plug the inverter into the car adapter outlet on the DC side. Now the inverter's on, and we're now powering our lamp. We're using 31 watts. Now we're going to power the same lamp using the alligator clips side of this inverter. These lugs at the bottom output 40 amps at 12 volts. I made it specifically for powering oddball things like alligator clips, where we don't have a USB connection or AC outlet. You can just hardwire things to it if you need to, in a pinch. This switch here powers this 40 amp buck converter, which in turn supplies voltage to these terminals. Our inverter's on. Now our light's on. So quickly, I just want to connect this pump to these terminals here and power this pump. Turn on our switch. Connect our positive and connect our negative. Now the pump's running. So the next thing I want to show you are the benefits of running directly off the battery using the DC side versus using the inverter for doing everyday things like charging your cell phone. For this test, we're going to show the efficiency of using the DC side versus the AC side. So we're going to monitor the Victron shunt while we charge the phone off the DC side, and then we're going to monitor it off the AC side. So currently everything is powered off. So if we pull up our Victron shunt, we can see that we're currently pulling 0 watts, which is as expected. So the first thing we want to do is turn on the DC side. It looks like we're pulling 4 watts. And that's just to power the relays on the back of the board, which supply the power to the USB outlets. Next, we're going to plug in our phone. And we can see that the phone takes a total of 19 watts to charge. That's including 4 watts to run the LEDs and the relays, and another 16 watts to run to actually charge the phone. Okay, so next we're going to charge the phone off of the AC inverter. So I have the DC side off and the Victron shunt is reading 0 watts. Let's turn on the inverter. So currently the AC output is off, but you notice that the inverter is using 60 to 65 watts just for doing nothing. It's literally sitting here idling, doing nothing. And that's because all inverters have something called idle consumption rate. That is the amount of power used for just running, not charging the battery, not getting any solar input, not any load, just to operate the inverter. So we're going to plug in our AC adapter for our phone. Turn on our AC output. Plug in the phone. Now we're getting 77 watts, so about 80 watts to charge this phone using the inverter versus just 19 watts using the DC side. So you can see how much more efficient it is to charge these devices off your DC side versus your AC side. If you live in a place where there's a lot of clouds or you don't get a lot of solar and every watt counts, you definitely want to think about installing a DC side to run your small electronics directly off your battery. So how much did I save on my power bill using this power station? Let's take a look. Okay, so we are looking at my July power bill from 2022. We can see that in that month, we saved at minus 24% from the year
previous year's July. So these light grayish blue bars are the previous year's. It says last year's. So last year's, and then this year's are these light blue bars. So you can see where this red line I drew, these are where I was on grid for the first 3 months of 2022. That's when I built the power station and I started using it sometime in March. And so the first month that it showed up on my power bill as a difference was in April. And it was, that's a little bit of difference, not huge. But then in May, there was a huge difference. You can see a pretty big difference in just running my household appliances. It does not include the AC unit, obviously. Just anything you can plug in around the house. So June was pretty significant. July was a little less. And then we can take a look at this next bill right here, which is for December. This is at the end of the year. And you'll notice a decrease of 50%, which is pretty huge. And that's because in the winter months, you tend to use less power. So the power that we do use, I pretty much cut it in half running everything off of the power station, because you're not using the AC. Here in Vegas, everything's about the AC unit. If you're not running your AC unit, well, that's 90% of your power consumption right there. So this blue bar represents the time I was running the off-grid power station. And you can see every month over month over month, there was just pretty noticeable decreases. So anywhere from 24% all the way to 50% power reduction in just using this power station.
If you want to see a video on the detailed review of this power station, click the link right here or find it below in the description. Well, that's it for this video, and as always, thanks for watching.